What up? I'm back. It's the July 29th. I'm kind of tired. I just got through painting one. I wasn't going to paint, but then I was like, you know, I want to paint. So I painted. It was pretty quick, man. It was a quick one. Man, it's super weird what my paint is right now. But I understand it. I understand it completely. And, you know what? I had some people come over to my house today and I just kind of reiterated, which this has nothing to do with anything other than my subconscious stuff. And it just reiterates, I guess, what my subconscious is yearning for, I guess. And this is embarrassing, I guess, kind of, but not really. I mean, we guess, but it's like that relationship. So it's coming out in my paintings every single time, and it's always two people, you know. And sometimes I would say that it was, because the whole time I've been painting, it's always the same thing. It's always the same thing, and then there's a dog in it, which makes zero sense. But then again, maybe it makes all the sense in the same. And yeah, but, I don't know, I love animals anyways, animals are cool, but, I don't know, man, it's super weird. I tore down some of my insulation from my wall, like, and painted on it, dude. Like, that's how much I care about painting. Like, I don't care about anything else. I had to paint. I built a bunch of paintings today, I don't know how many, a lot of them. Some of them are big, and it was fun. It was cool. My fingers freaking sore as crap because I shot a nail through it, and a little tender-hearted fella right now. But it is what it is. I sliced my finger open on a staple. That was cool. It bled pretty good, but whatever. It's just part of it, man. It is what it is. Fingers been smashed up a bunch. My whole life, really. Like, what's this? This is just regular. It is sore. It's going to be sore tomorrow. But, whatever. It's just part of it. It's part of it. Today was cool, man. I'm trying to think of what my day consisted of. Listen to my talk a bunch today. Dude, I have no idea what it was about now. I always forget. I don't know why. I guess it's, I just listen to it so much. It's just like now it's programmed into me, and I'm good forever with it. And it's super cool process because it's like I hear it 5, 6, 7 times, you know. And so like all that information that I talked about the night before, like I get to hear it so many times. I listened to it 2 times last night, and oh dang, I got a freaking crazy. So this is crazy, man. I went to sleep last night. I don't know what time I went to sleep. I had a dream. The dream was weird. I'm gonna talk about it just because I want it on record and I want to hear it tomorrow. But the dream was, we were driving in a car. It was me and my older sister and my little brother. And he was younger. My sister was probably like dating age or older, you know, maybe 20s. And then my mom was driving the car. And we were going to the funeral place, the graveyard, or whatever you call it, cemetery. We were driving there. And it was weird because we were going to see her grave. But she was driving, and we've been there many times because the way that the family works, they have a bunch of plots, whatever, so everyone's buried there. And so we drive in and we go in there, and like my mom knows the way, but then she went the wrong direction down a road that was kind of parallel to it. And when we get there, we end up having to turn around and park. But when that happened, like someone else was driving, someone with my sister, was driving, and I know who it is, but I'm not going to talk about that. And, someone else was driving, and it was weird, and, like, my little brother got out and ran. Such long days and longer nights, visions running through my mind. It kind of disappeared. And we had to walk through this place. So we walked through the place, and there was like a weird shaped door on the other side of the door. And the guy that was driving, he opened it, and it was like a really small door, like a little bitty door. And he jokes about me going through that door, and I just laughed or whatever. And that's significant for certain reasons, but but then we walk out the door, and my mom's grave is down yonder, quite a ways, and there's like a row of trees in the way. There's like the road on the right, and then. You know, we're kind of worried about my little brother because we don't know where he went. We can't find him. So, like, whatever. He knows where it is. We're just walking towards, you know, her grave. Really far away. Probably, like, 50 yards, 100 yards. Like, half a football field away, maybe. And, he's real little. And he has like a little bowl cut, cute as it could be. This is a child. And we're kind of looking for him, and we're walking. And like I said, we're super far away. And kind of like, there's a row of trees, and for some reason, like my mom's grave is like protruding on the left side just a little bit, and it's standing up. It's kind of tall, you know, as tall as he is. And this is super far away. And dude, and I don't know, they're up in front of me, like my sister and whoever. And I'm farther back. And I just lose my shit. I lose it. Like, I'm on the ground in fetal position, just bawling. And, like, as soon as that happened, like, it just clicked in my head. Because he was just sitting there. Just talking away. Just spending time. Something we can't even freaking see. Like, nothing ever happened. And, but for me, I just felt, I was just overwhelmed with, dude, I was just bawling. I woke up crying in my sleep. Like, just bawling. And, it was just the weirdest thing. Because I wasn't, like, sad. But she was gone. It was the act of that little kid just still talking and just loving and just giving her time, and just, I don't even understand it. Like, it's so confusing to me. But it was weird because I was filled with this overwhelming emotion, and I couldn't move. I was just crying because it was like the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. The innocence of a child. And it's almost like, man, I don't know, because it had a weird correlation with me. And it's almost like, the little kid got it, and it was just, I don't know, it was perfect. It was weird, man. It broke me. It broke me so bad. Like, I wake up in the middle of the night crying, and dude, I don't know, it messed me up. It messed me up last night, and I didn't know what was going on. It makes me cry now just talking about it, but then as soon as I get to the child part, I kind of like, I don't understand it. Because it's almost like I took all these feelings, I took all these emotions, and then it mirrored me. And it mirrored me of something that I've lost, but I didn't lose it. Something I have, but I never had it. Something that's there, but that's not there. And it's like, it's very confusing because, dude, I mean, I was crying a second ago. I couldn't even talk through it, but I don't get it. Because, like I said, I walk over the hill and I see him and he's just talking, and it broke me. It just broke me. Like, not understanding, maybe. The not understanding that someone's gone. And, but maybe they know more than we do. And, I don't know, maybe it has to do with me and you know, my biological mother or my biological that, you know, where it's just like, it's all about perspective, man. It's all about perspective. And if a little kid can continue to talk to somebody, it's like, why can't we? Because they're not really gone, their energy's still here. And I've talked about this before. I've talked about it many times before. Where it's like, the reason why I hold doors open is because of my mom. The reason why I'm polite is because of my mother. The reason I am who I am is because of her. I mean, I know this. I know this completely. You know, the reason why I act white is because of my mother. The reason why I talk the way I talk is because of her. You know, it's cool. And a lot of times I don't get emotional, but whatever, when the emotions come, I gotta feel them. And I had some people come, like I said, I had some people stop by and whatever, she told me some stuff about my mom and whatever when she passed away, and it was cool, but I had no emotion when she told me that. I still don't have emotion for it right now. It doesn't make a difference to me, because I'm not, you know, like I said, when my mom passed, like I said, I shaped everything to gratitude instantly, so I overcame that grief instantly. For that time, and I outweighed it with, I was happy for the 35 years I had with her, and I wasn't worrying about the fact that she was gone at that moment, or in this, the totality of it. I had 35 years with her. I've only had, you know, almost a year without her. So even in the moment, it's doing what it's doing, but in the totality of it, the scale outweighs, you know, and my gratitude wins. You know, that's kind of the point of it. If I can start the foot on gratitude, then it's like, I can just keep building on that. I don't have to imagine 35 years from now, be like, well, I've not had 35 years with my mother now. Now it's equal. And then at 36 or 37, then it's going to become negative again. No, that's not how it works. I mean, that's not what I'm choosing to do. I guess you could do it. But for me, all about scale. And I'm grateful for the 35 years I had. I'm not worried about the one that I don't. Because I have enough memories to last me a lifetime. And everything I do, you know, she imprinted on me. I learned from her. I watched her. So it's cool. The dream was weird. Dude, to wake up crying in the fetal position is weird. And just the emotion that came with it was so real. It just dropped me in the middle of a freaking field. There was nothing I could do. And it was just, like I said, to me, it felt like I was watching almost two kids. Two little kids. And I kind of look at it like, so I have an older brother and a little brother. You know, when they were little, they looked pretty damn close to being identical twins. Like, even though they were so many years apart, like, the pictures looked the same. Like, so maybe that's all we needed, you know? I didn't need, because I know this. I know that you're always a kid. And that little version of you is always in you. And it tends to be so that that little version of you is what's damaged the most and damaged the earliest. And so a lot of times we have to abandon that little kid. I abandoned mine. I abandoned myself, little Hoss, and I had to do what I had to do to survive. I didn't let him be a kid anymore. I didn't have time. I was just trying to survive, get love, get attention, and go through life like that. And then it is what it is. It made me who I am. It made me a world breaker, you know, and a world maker. It made me all these things. It gave me all these abilities. It allowed me to mimic. It allowed me to become a master chameleon. It allowed me to mirror the world. It allowed my purpose. And that so-called life, that suffering, those lessons, the bad, the sadness, disappointment in humans, the abandonment, oh, the abandonment. Maybe me. As soon as I choose to take power, take it back. And then bring that little kid back up and let him live, let him play. Let him get the time that he didn't get. And yet I'm still an adult. I'm still doing adult things. Yeah, it's shifted a little bit. You know, and now I don't focus on money per se. I don't really care. It's weird. It's weird to live this way. But it's the right way for me to live right now. And I understand that even if I only give Hoss like a true year and a half to live in the play, and then I'm gonna have to become more of an adult. But I don't think so. I think I found the right balance of it. I think I'm in the right balance of it. Where I walk around the world as an adult and as a kid. And I find the good, I find the amazing, I find the beautiful, I find the perfection in everything. And I give people the benefit of the doubt. And I try. I do. I honestly do. I give them benefit of doubt until they do something that they can't take back. And then at that point, it's done. I can't be part of that anymore. I did my best. I did all I thought I could do. I just did what I thought it was worth it to me. I would do it again if I had to, but sometimes things, it is what it is. It's just life. Life is tough, and sometimes you do things you can't take back. And that's what's super weird, is because I woke up. That was the only reason why I woke up, was because of that dream. And then some series of events happened, and it is what it is. It hurts me inside, but, you know, endless hope is endless hope, and I have it for everyone until I don't. I don't. I did my best. I tried. To say I was disappointed would be, I'm nothing now. You know, it's not even, I'm not even, I don't even have disappointment. I already knew. It just is, and that's it. That's all I'm gonna say about that. That dream last night, though, it woke me up at a certain time for a certain reason, so I could see a certain thing. And, it was super weird, and whatever. Today was cool, man, and I did a bunch of paintings. I'm gonna get off this subject for a minute. But my mom was cool, you know, and that's what I'm saying. That's why I, you know, the woman told me something about my mom, and to me, it really didn't faze me. I really had no emotion. Cause that's what I'm saying, like, my gratitude won over whatever someone tells me, you know? Like, and that's kind of how I live now. It's like, it's cool, I appreciate it, it was sweet, awesome, I love it, thank you. And I mean, I needed to hear it. Obviously I'm talking about it, and, but at the end of the day, it's like, I already knew, I already came to terms with it. You know, and that's just Cody, man. And like I said, it doesn't mean I won't grieve her every now and then. I won't cry. I won't think about her. Because it sucks. It does suck in the end of the day. Like, but it's part of life. You know, it's part of it. And for her not to be here anymore, like, she's not suffering. She's not having to manage bills. She's not, you know, that any of the negative stuff, you would say, and she doesn't have that stress or that worry. And so, like, for me, it's like I always see the best. It's like she's not seeing any of that stuff anymore. I don't have to worry about her. She's okay. And that's fun. You know, that's kind of how that's what I'm saying. The gratitude thing changed everything when my mom passed away. And I was like, dude, like, this, I can't let this win. I was like, I'm not going to let this eat me alive. And I'm not going to be incapacitated in the present because of something that's out of my control in the first place, and something that's just part of life, and it is what it is, and her suffering is gone, you know, and that's freaking bonus for me. It sucks that she's not here anymore, but if I know she's not struggling, I know, like, that makes me happy that she's not struggling. It sucks she's not here, but it sucks she's not going to meet my kids, or she's not ever going to meet my wife, and, but they get to meet me. And I'm just a colored version, you know, of her, and, just left out in the sun a little too long, and, but I still have a lot of her traits, and I have a lot of her, and that's cool. That's cool. But yeah, man, I went and worked out this morning. I did some yoga. I really wasn't feeling it, but I did it anyways, and I don't know, I was kind of off today. I think it was a dream, and then just kind of a series of events that happened last night, and it kind of just bummed me out a little bit. It's okay to be bummed sometimes, but you just feel, I don't know, man. That's what I'm saying. Like, I feel disappointed, but I don't know. I try not to think about it, because it was like, I don't see how I could have changed anything different or helped anybody different. It is what it is. To each his own, man. You create the own world you live in, and that just reiterates to me that, like, we are in control of our own world, and we deal with our repercussions, man. We really do. And I'm a testament to that. But I look at my life over the last year and a half, and it's like, dude, I've slowly been walking away from everything already. Like, just the way I was doing things, I was walking away. I was walking away in a different, controlled, slow way where I was dragging things on. I'm kind of forcing people's hands and stuff like that in a weird way. And I didn't think that I was doing it. But it was just the totality of everything. Well, I just started focusing on me and understanding that this time in my life, like, I don't care what happens to me financially. Like, I was like, dude, like, I have to fix myself. I have to give myself time for the first time in my life. I'll be able to recoup. That's not a problem. But right now, it's just like, that's not my focus. It's just like, Cody, you got to take care of yourself. You got to look at yourself. I'm giving you a little bit of time. I'm going to give you some time, and you're going to just do the work. Every single day. I'm not going to skip a day. You're going to constantly be growing every day. You're constantly going to be testing yourself every day. You're constantly going to be learning every single day. You're constantly going to be giving yourself time, because for 35 years you did. You did not. And so that, and now it's me. It's right here, and I'm doing whatever, man. Creating art that makes zero sense to me other than its subconscious coming out of me. And it always leaning towards the same thing, which is companionship, I think. And it's cool. I like it. Sometimes it's kind of annoying because it's like, whatever, but it's part of me. It's what's calling out from my heart. And honestly, what's so crazy is, like, a year and a half ago, I didn't care anything about it. I was fine being by myself and not having a companion. And I didn't care anything about it. I didn't think anything about it. And now it's just like every day it's coming out in my art in some form or fashion. Like, my vibration is that. Like, I'm in that vibration of love and looking for that counterpart. And there's nothing I could do about it. I can't stop it. I don't know why. I guess it's just because it's this part of my chapter. It's like I lost. And I've said this. I've said that, you know, I surrendered to my mother. And I know that I was always been capable of loving one human being at a time. Like that. Like, whatever. Especially a woman. Like, completely. You know. And being that I surrendered everything to her so I could survive. You know. And I signed a contract or surrendered everything to her, and then when she passed away, she ripped that contract was ripped off. It was null and void, and then now it's like, boom, I'm free. You know, and then now it's like my body is just like, you're ready for the real thing now. The thing that's actually gonna, the person that's actually gonna love you back the way that you deserve to be loved, now that you love yourself. Now that you've done the work for a year and a half. Now that you took the time to unconditionally love yourself and to respect yourself and to grow and understand how this works, now you're capable of it. Now you're ready for it. And so I guess that's just what my body, my mind, my subconscious is doing and saying and attracting. I don't really know. You know, I'm just being me every day. And I don't know, dude. And then this song came on, and another song. There's two songs that I painted into this, maybe three, but this song did the most of it. And the other song, literally, I painted like 2 seconds with it. Not mostly just because I had to, but this is the song that matters. This is the song that is the reason why I painted it. But then again, my painting doesn't have to be exactly what life is for me. But this song and this talk will explain it. Well, this is the important part. The last 2 seconds, the last minute, last song doesn't matter at all. Especially in my mind. Because this is what's going to happen. And this is, you know. But life is crazy, man. And today was cool. Like, dude, I don't know how many I did. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I don't know, maybe 12 paintings or more. I don't know how many I built today. I built quite a few. I got maybe 10 left to frame out, and then that would be those. And I don't know, I'm just ready, man. Who knows what's gonna happen, man. I'm ready to have a show and just let people see my stuff, man. That's really it for me. I just want people to feel my stuff. I want people to be in the presence of my stuff. And then that just seems cool to me, because that stuff in there, those art, that art is me, man. It's real, you know. And being that my whole life, like, I talked to someone today and she's like, "You never talk." And I was like, "Yeah, you're surprised. You'll be surprised how much I talked in the last year and a half. I've talked more in the last year and a half than I've talked my whole life, guaranteed. Guaranteed. Gotta take that to the bank." Yeah. I've talked so much, man. Like, it's my time to talk. You know? I let everyone else talk the whole life. Now I got something to say. And it's been fun, man. It's been the extreme opposite, but it's I've rolled back into balance now. I talk when I need to talk, and I'm quiet when I need to be quiet. And doesn't mean I don't get excited. It doesn't mean I don't get worked up, but it just means that I'm balanced, and I'm ready for the future. I'm ready for whatever's in store for me, and it's gonna be cool. It's gonna be perfect, and it's gonna be fun as hell. And evidently, hell is fun because I've decided to live in it for 35 years, you know. And but it's way more fun out here in heaven. Where I'm in peace always. Even with a couple minutes of me crying and being sad, and it's like, overall, it's like, that's just a brief moment in my day. That's just part of it. It has to be there. You have to constantly have the opposite to love the press, to love the peace, to love the joy. Like, you have to have down times and bad times to appreciate the good, the highs, you know? And that's why it's just like, I just walk with peace, because I know even if I'm down for a minute, if I'm down for a day, it doesn't matter, because I have to feel it. I have to listen to it. What is it trying to tell me? What do I need to focus on so it doesn't control me for the rest of my life? I just need to face it when it comes. Feel it, respect it, because it's me. It's part of me. You know? I'm the controller of my chaos. You know, I'm the controller of my mind. When I catch it, when I stop, when I listen to what it's saying and wants me to do, how it wants me to respond to something, a question, I answer it the way I want to answer it. I don't let it control me. But it's hard to get there, man. It takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of listening to yourself and pride and ego battles. But it's worth it, dude. It's worth it. It's cool, man. I saw this, a little bit of the sunset. Not much. I didn't even get to paint till later. But it all worked out exactly the way it was supposed to. Like, I'm just so content with time. And the way that it flows and goes, like, everything that I need to do, I do. Everything that needs to happen, happens. And I'm okay with it. Because if I don't do something, then I wasn't meant to do it. And if I do something, then I'm meant to do it. And I'm just okay with that. And it's no biggie. It just is what it is. And as time goes by, like, and the more you talk to yourself, and the more you just become more aware of everything, the processes of life, and you kind of, it's almost like you're just walking side by side you, or you're walking at a higher perspective than you, even if you're still seeing out your eyes, you just feel different, like, time feels different. I wouldn't say it's slower, but it's slower, because you're just observing so much more. You're getting so much more information. And man, my fingers are sore. That one finger is going to be sore as crap tomorrow, bro. I need to probably cut it open and put some stuff in it. But it all work out, man. Pop that bone. But yeah, man, I don't know. That thing has like side lights protruding out the side of it. That's weird, bro. That was the weirdest car I've ever seen. But yeah, I don't know, man. Today was cool. Like I said, I'm happy I got what I got done today. I was kind of slow. I guess. I don't know. I was just trying to make everything perfect. One of the frames I kind of messed up and it was racked weird and I had to pull it all apart and then re-rack it. But I don't know. I'm just trying to get my stuff out there. I don't know. I think it's cool, man. I really do. I think some of them are super cool. Some of them are kind of just more of like me in the moment. And like this painting here, like the very end, I covered up my painting and I made it blurry for a reason. Number one, because I don't like the figures in it. Number two is because the last song that I picked, you know, it talks about what we do to love, and it's like a lot of times we just hide it. We hide that we love, you know, because we're scared, we're afraid, when there's no reason to be. And but based on our trauma, based on our life, based on our previous experiences, we're afraid. And there's no reason to really be afraid, because what's the point of being afraid? I don't know. Like, why would I be afraid of something now? I shouldn't be afraid of anything. Because whatever happens, happens. And, it'll all work out in the end. And even if it's for a minute, for an hour, for a day, like, it seems worth it to me. Because it's a lesson. And it's gonna be fun. Until it's not fun anymore. But I'm looking for eternity, man. I'm looking forever. I'm not playing jump around game. That makes zero sense. I'm one and done, you know? But that's just me. I don't know. I'm weird. I'm different. I'm Cody. I'm a Hoff. 24/7, man. But life is fun. And I'm glad I painted today. I really am. And it happened really quick because I wasn't gonna, because it was getting late. I was like, you know, I'm just gonna go sit in my truck and talk. And then I was like, no, I'm gonna go paint. I'm just gonna go paint. I don't have a lot of paint left. I don't have a lot of colors. But I was like, whatever. Whatever happens, happens. Because this is what I like to do. This is what I love to do. This is me. And I don't feel right if I don't paint. You know, I may not paint tomorrow. I don't know. Who knows what's gonna happen tomorrow? Tomorrow's a new day. And which gets to my point from yesterday, where I was talking about like my playlist. So there was one day, I don't know when it was, a couple weeks ago, when I don't know, it just felt like a new day, you know. It may have been a new moon or something like that, and or a full moon. So like whatever, something happened and I was like, you know what, this is new. This is a new part of my life. I overcame some stuff. This is a new part of my transformation, and so I made this new playlist called New Day, and then that's what I've been painting off of, and I'll add songs to it every day, because it was a new day, and it started a new version of Cody, and I think it was like when I kind of brought Cody back, the old Cody, and I brought back his old skills, and I brought back, like, you know, the possibility of being angry and stuff like that, and just all those traits that some would say that are negative, but I just say that they're darker traits. But dark is not bad. Dark is there for a reason. It's a lot of my protection traits. It's a lot of, you know, a lot of good skills to have. And when I blended them back for the first couple of days, I was a little off. I was a little weird. I was getting more agitated and stuff for the first couple of days until I could yin and yang it. Until I could blend it in and become three. And, but it worked out. It worked out. And, so now I'm kind of standing in that, and I'm understanding, you know, I got dark and I got light, and I use both, and, I grab power from both, and I grab skill from both, I grab knowledge from both. And it's not good or bad, it just is what it is to be the best in this world, to be the best version of yourself in this world. You have to be able to be both. learn from both. You know. But whatever, man. So yeah, this playlist is New Day. And I don't know, man. Super cool. Super cool. And I'm hungry. I'm hungry. My finger's sore as crap. It's tender. It's swelled up a little bit, but then it happened like first thing this morning when I started. But whatever, man. I don't know. But yeah, I had two people pull up in my yard, and like I said, we ended up talking for a while, and I guess it was cool. It was good. It was exactly what it needed to be. I wasn't expecting it. I think it was needed on both parts. And life is tough, man. And every time I look at my life, I'm like, dude, I'm so blessed. I got it so easy. You know, compared to some people in this life, they've had it rough, man. It's like I look at what I've gone through, and it's like, it's not that bad. It's not that bad being alone my whole life, or feeling alone, or feeling unloved. Like, that's not that bad. That's just regular to me. Like, I was bred for it. I was made for it. But now, I'm worthy of it. I'm worthy of having it that I didn't have my whole life. And now I know how to give it. And I know how to give it completely. And I'm excited about it. Like I said, if there was one goal in my life, it's that. That seems that, and to have kids, like, and then to be able to raise kids and put them through a life that is everything opposite of what I got. You know, just everything to the top, turned up. Freaking love the piss out of them kids. They never doubt that I love them. I'll give you that. They're never gonna doubt it. Ever. And I'm excited. I can't even imagine. I have little kids. That's crazy to me. I have a little version of me. Except he won't be walking around with curly hair. Well, he may have curly hair, but he won't be walking around with freaking his fist clenched. I hope that. He may be angry sometimes, but that's just natural, you know. But I'm excited, man, because these little kids is the future, man. That's what I said, dude. I walked over that hill and saw, looked like my little brother, man, and it broke me. Just talking away. I don't know what it was. I can't even explain it. I cannot explain the emotion of me walking and just seeing him just standing there, talking, having fun. Like, I don't know if it was the innocentness of him or what. Like I said, dude, I remember at the funeral home with my mom up there in her casket, whatever. So much easier to hide than to face what we might find. My little brother's daughter was standing up there. And there was like a little brown kid, little black kid, and then there was another little kid. Dude, and I saw it and I was like, fuck. Like, it just broke me inside then. Just because they were just looking at her and they didn't really understand. And, it's so innocent. Like, because she just wanted to show them. Her Nina, you know. I don't know why you won't. Cause the It sucks, dude. For the longest time, like, after my mom passed, like, every time I saw my niece, dude, I would freaking just be... I would break. Every single time. Every single time. Dude, I was cutting grass. And for a long time, dude, every single time I saw a little kid, dude, I would just cry. I would cry so bad, because it's like... Because I kept shifting into them. I kept, like, shifting into their mind. Like, I can't explain it other than, like, I would just shift into a little kid. Like, a little kid perspective. And just be so fucking confused and broken. Like, I don't understand. And then, like... But I understand it was, like, me kind of grieving little Cody. And, I'm just freaking breaking every single time. Just grieving for me abandoning myself. And for me, that little Cody feeling alone his whole life. And that little Cody being alone his whole life. And I was like, God, like... It sucks because I never really cried for him. And, I just made him do what he had to do. He just did what he had to do to survive. And it wasn't easy. Hell, it wasn't fair. It was not fair at all. And that's what I said. Little kids break me, man. All of them. I hate it. I hate that they gotta go through stuff. Dude, I hate it so much. And it's just because I was fucking hurt so bad when I was little. So I feel for it. I mean, that's why I'm empathetic. Because I've been through it. I lived it. I was it. I was nothing but pain and anger my whole life. Especially when I was a kid. It sucked. It was the worst. It was the worst. But I made it. But it doesn't mean, like, when you start... That's what I'm saying. That's what sucks about this journey. That did suck about this journey. It didn't. It was good. It was cool. Now that I look at it, but it does break me. It does make me cry. But that's just why I have just, like... That's why I just don't give a fuck about adults, to be honest with you. I do. Honestly, I don't. I don't care about adult versions of people. I care about the little kid inside. Because that's what's hurt. That's what's damaged. And so we have to heal that. And the only way to heal that is to make that exist again. You know? And I'll, you know, dude, I'm so blunt and mean sometimes, but that's it. And that's what I see, dude. That's what I see with every human. Even a 97-year-old man, dude, I see what, I'm like, I see a little kid. Like, I see the innocentness still. I see what happened a long time ago, and it's like, that's what hurt you. That's why you're the way you are now, is because of that. It's why you can't love, like, you know, I couldn't love anyone. That's why I was disappointed in people. That's why I had to deal with my emotions by myself when I was little, because no one could comfort me. You know, that's why I'm independent, I guess. Because no one was there for me. That's why I don't ask for help, because no one helped me when I was little. I didn't trust anyone, because I didn't trust anyone when I was little. Because there was no one to trust. Dude, and little kids fucking trust everybody. So something happened. For the reason why I don't trust. Because little kids trust everyone. I trusted no one. I only trusted a few people in my life. When I was little. Weird, and that's probably what one of the dream was weird. It's weird. I don't even know. One day that shit's gonna pop in my head, and I'm gonna be pissed. I'm gonna be pissed. Someone's gonna get in trouble. Cause I'm gonna come. I'm gonna come for you. When that memory comes back, it's gonna be a problem. It's gonna be a big problem. Hopefully not. Maybe I don't have to do justice to that. It's really the big problem. That's what I'm saying, man, and that's the point of all of it. Is the little kid versions is what gets destroyed. And those, and they get destroyed, they get abandoned, they get locked in the closet, and they hide. And they hide, and they hide, and they hide. And then when we grow up and become adults, all we do is escape. Because if we sit with ourselves, we have to look at ourselves, and ultimately we're looking at that little kid version that was hopeless, that had no hope, that was freaking unprotected from their parents. Well, it was supposed to be there to protect them, but those, they're little kids too. And their parents didn't protect them. Their parents probably hurt them. And then our parents hurt us. And it's just a bunch, it's just a world of little broken kids. Innocent kids that literally got their innocence robbed away and stolen. That's why it's like no matter what I do, whatever I say, like, it's always about the kids. Protect them now. Give them a chance. Give them a freaking chance, bro. Just because we didn't have it, just because we got robbed, doesn't mean they deserve it, because they do not. They do not. They don't deserve any of it. They don't deserve the sins of your father or the sins of your son. They don't deserve that. Fix your shit so you don't, so your kids don't have that. Be a man, be a woman, take care of it. You know? Your dad was a drunk, but don't be a drunk. Better yourself in every way possible. You didn't get love, love the piss out of your kids. Make damn sure you love them completely. That's what I'm saying. That's why, like, when I was out and the guy just let his son hug him, and he just let him freaking hug him as much as he wanted to hug him. That broke me. And then again, like I said, I saw a grown woman hug her dad, and that fucking broke me. I don't even know what that's like. It's weird to me. Completely love somebody and trust them. It's weird. I don't get it. It's like, how is that even possible? I mean, I honestly feel that way about myself now. But I can't, like, hug. I guess I could hug myself. My arms don't work that way, but I can touch my shoulders, I guess. You know, I can hug my biceps like that. I can hug like a bicep hug. Oh, short T-Rex ass arms. I don't know, man. It's beautiful to see it in life, in real life, though, man. Cause now, man, now I just got visions of adults right now. But it's like, it's almost like a cartoon of, it's a vision of adults, but then they got broke as a child, and it's like, it's like we're all just, all has to do with that trauma. It all has to do with that first event that changed you for the rest of your life. And it's like, well, how do you go back and face it? How do you go back and change it? How do you go back and take your power back from whatever happened from the very, very first time? The very first time you lost trust. The very first time you didn't understand something. You didn't understand why this was happening. You didn't understand why this person was doing that to you. But now that you're an adult and you have more knowledge, you can just hop in that spaceship. That was the first song. The first song was something about building a spaceship for me. And I made like a quick little spaceship with my spray paint and something. And it's so weird. So you step in your little spaceship, in your time-traveling ship, man, and you just shoot back as far back as you can remember to that first moment, to that first loss of trust, to that first idea that broke you. The first place that brought you to fear. The first place that brought you to not be in love. The first abandonment issue. The first unworthiness issue. The first time you got turned down by somebody for being a fucking different color. For the first time anything happened to you that just shattered your self-worth. And look at it again, living it again, feel it again. But this time feel it like an adult, like a man, like a woman. And overcome it, figure out what the lesson is. You know, and a lot of times you're going to look at it like you're going to shoot back to the first time someone, you know, said you were a different color so they couldn't date you. And you're just like, well, that had nothing to do with me. It just had to do with their insecurities, and they were a child too. And maybe their parents didn't want, you know, they didn't know. They were afraid what their parents would say. They were afraid what their parents would do. They were afraid what other people would say. It has nothing to do with me. Yeah, it broke me. Yeah, it messed me up. And then I go through and do the chain of events as well. Like, you know. If someone did it to me, so I do it to them. Hurt people, hurt people. I mean, I was a freaking child. But it messes you, it stains you. But you go back to that and you take that back and it's like, it had nothing to do with her. Yeah, it had nothing to do with me. It was whatever she was going. She didn't know it, but she was a child. Who cares? Whatever happened, happened. It meant to be that way, I guess. To teach you a lesson for the future. And now you can step into your confidence. And it's okay that you look the way you do. You know, I don't know where I lost trust. But I don't remember ever really having it. But then again, it's like you come from... Obviously, I couldn't trust anyone anyways from day one. Because day one, the woman who was supposed to keep me, who was supposed to love me, who was me, broke all trust because she abandoned me. She gave me up. Yes, it was more complicated than that. But that's what a little kid, that's where a little kid gets broke. He doesn't understand. He's an innocent little kid who doesn't understand. And he's incapable of understanding. And it's imprinted on him for all of eternity until he goes back and he looks at it again as an adult. Or when he's a child and the parents that he's with go back time traveling with him over and over again till the kid understands what really happened. Over and over and over again. And you look at life and it's like sometimes you gotta do stuff that sucks, man. Sometimes you gotta be the bad guy. Sometimes Cody has to say things straight out and if it offends you, it offends you. But that's love. You know, I told someone today, I was like, look. I was like, sometimes you have to fucking hold people. You just gotta hold them, even when they shake and kick, even if they're grown ass people. And you gotta hold them. They're shaking, kicking, they're pissed off. You gotta hold them until they feel loved. That means they're gonna kick, they're gonna scream, they're gonna fight, they're gonna be uncomfortable as hell. You gotta hold them past that. You gotta keep holding them. You do not let them go. Because it's a little kid version inside of them that's so broken that they think no matter what, at some point you're gonna leave them. So therefore, you have to hold them until they trust you. Until they know you will never leave them. Meaning you have to do stuff in love and be the bad guy until they understand you are the good guy. That you will suffer as long as it's needed to let them know that you love them. And that you won't leave them. And you'll do everything in your power always to stay with them. You always have their back. As long as it's not outrageous. You know? But that's it. Because we're all just little kids in adult bodies, man. All of us. That's why we go run around. That's why we run the streets. That's why we try and find love. and physical stuff, and that's why we try and just get attention from everybody or anybody. We're so broken. Because we needed attention from our parents and we didn't get it. There was divorce. There was death. They were broken too. They couldn't give us the attention we needed because they couldn't even take care of themselves. They were just barely making it by. And in doing so, they abandoned us. The little kids. We had to fend for ourselves. And we had to grow up super quick. And ultimately, now, we just constantly run because if we taste a little bit of freedom and now we can do whatever we want, like we try and have as much fun as we possibly can because we didn't get it when we were little. We don't want to be locked down. We're afraid of companionship because we think someone's going to leave us and do exactly what happened in our past again. When the going gets tough, everyone's going to run. And I'm not good enough. I'm not worthy of this. And I'm a mess up. And I don't know how to choose good for myself. And I'm broken. No one really loves me. People only want me for my body. People only want me for my looks. People only want me for my money. And if you walk around thinking that, then you're going to end up with people that do that. Because you get what you give. You project and then you get reflected back. You meet humans that do that to you because you're self-fulfilling your prophecy. You have that much power. You are in control. But there's some humans that think opposite of all that. I want nothing from you. I would like your time in the moment. You know? And if we're more than that, then hell yeah, let's roll. We can go on forever. But I only have room for one. I mean, I'll give you love and time in the moment. I'll give you attention in the moment. I'll help you in the moment. I'll be vulnerable in the moment. I'll do anything in my power to help you understand who you really are on the inside. You're a strong human being that's capable of anything. Now, whatever happened to you in the past, happened. Now, I'll help walk you through it to take your power back from it. And so we cannot let our kids fall trapped to the same thing. And once you overcome what you've overcome, you can help so many more people. You can inspire so many more people. Because when I light your match, you're going to be lit too. And you can shine your light bright as hell because you are. Quit hiding it under a bush. Quit hiding it with your insecurities when you're freaking fire. You're amazing. You're you. There's no one else like you. There shouldn't be anyone else like you. You're a freaking nerd about this. You're a nerd about that. You have all this knowledge. You have all this power. You have all this love. But you gotta love yourself. You gotta use that knowledge to help yourself. You gotta give yourself time. Because you're worthy of all the time. So much easier to hide than to face what we might find. There'd be so much less to It's so fun, man. The more that we fight, at the start of this journey, I told somebody, I said, hey, look. I was like, I'm bringing this little hoss back up. This little kid. I probably didn't say hoss. I said little Cody. A little version of Cody. And I'm going to do whatever I can to let that kid live and heal him. I want you to do it with me. So we can do it together. Seems like a fun deal to me. Because that was my purpose. That's always been my purpose, to do it with other people. to help them come too. Why would I want to do this alone? That makes zero sense. Why would I want to walk the world healed and happy? And no one else is. Or some people probably are, but I mean, just saying, like, you know, that makes zero sense. Why would I want to go do something if it doesn't help other people? That makes zero sense to me. If I can't inspire people and show them and give them away the way I've done stuff and be vulnerable enough and cry and whine and complain and be crazy, have different voices, why would I even do what I did? Why would I even gave myself time? Because in the bigger picture, in the bigger scale of things, we're all worthy of everything. And sometimes we need just to be able to see somebody else going through the same stuff. We gotta feel that somebody else is telling us the truth and not lying. And that people actually do love us enough to be freaking the martyr. To be the joke. To be vulnerable. To talk about my struggles. To talk about my insecurities. To talk about my problems. To talk about my abandonment issues, my trust issues. To talk about shit that's happened to me in the past that I still can't even get full visions of. I can smell and taste it. That's the worst part. That's the fucking worst part. I don't even have the visions. I just know. It's disgusting. I hate it. It's embarrassing. Fucking embarrassing. The more we deny it, it comes out. The more we stay quiet, it gets loud. It gets loud. Because we were kids. I was a kid. The child. Everything happened exactly the way it did because it had to. No point in dwelling on the past. So maybe I'll never really fully look into it. You know? I don't know. That's kind of what I told that kid, the UPS dude. I was like, dude, some of the stuff you don't have to face, man. Like I'm saying, you just go back and face some of the big stuff. Some of the other stuff, you'll get past it, you won't even think about it anymore. Because once you find that level of peace, you find that level of acceptance of all of this, of the universe, of the world, of the way time works, the way your brain works, the way you can be in control, how you can choose to accept whatever happens, happens, and be okay and understand that you're a freaking monster and you've made it to this point. You survived all the way to this point, so anything in the past that you have faced, you've overcame it, you're a freaking monster. And there's no reason to be afraid. Because it will all work out in the end. And honestly, once you die, you're dead. That should be the only thing we're afraid of. But once you're dead, you're dead. It's over. You can't think, you can't see, you can't hear. You're gone. The game is over. Shut off. Power went off. It sucks. But there's nothing you can do about it. The only thing that matters is now. And how you react now. How you respond now. How do you live now? How do you love now? How do you give your time that is happening right now? Which is the only thing you can control, which is the now. Because the past is perfect. The past is done. The past is not even real. The past is part of your imagination. And the future never comes. You will never make it to the future. The only time is now. How are you going to use it? You going to play in your imagination? You going to let the past control you? You going to let the past deem how you make choices now? You going to let the past keep you in bed all day? You going to let the past not let you love and have relationships? You gonna let the past dictate how you treat your children? Are you going to choose how you want to treat your children? Are you going to choose to wake up and get up every single day? You're going to choose to love everyone that you see. You're going to choose who you give time to now. Are you going to choose to be the best version of yourself? Are you going to choose to be happy? You get to choose it. And anyone who says that you don't, or you can't just say, don't be, you can just be happy. You can. There's a process to get there. You have to do things and change your life. You have to change what you do in the now. It's kind of a process. It's a little bit of a process, but you can choose. Because this is your life, this is your perspective. You can choose your perspective. You can choose to see what you want to see. You can choose to believe what you want to believe. You can choose to believe in God, or you can choose to believe in something else. That's your choice, that's free will. It doesn't matter if you're a Christian or you're not a Christian. You get that option. You can choose that when you eat something, it's going to do good. Gonna do what it needs to do. It may still happen no matter what, but you can choose it. You know, that's life. I can choose to sit in my bedroom all day long, but time is still gonna go on. But what's your choice? That's what I'm saying. You get to choose everything. So freaking start choosing. Even if I talk about, like, the world chose for me in the past, the world didn't choose for me. I still had to act out the actions that I did. That's part of the whole process anyways, is starting to take accountability for your own actions. And not really be a victim anymore, because it happened. And you gotta, in order to not be a victim, you gotta go back and fight it again. Like, you're choosing to go back in time. You're choosing to relive that again. You're not a victim. Once you choose to go back, you're not a victim. The first time you were a victim. But now you're choosing to go relive it again. It's your choice. But in order to overcome something, you have to go face it again. Or you can sit here right now and just continue to be a victim. Because it did happen to you. And you can sit there and relive it every time. And you can sit there and give whoever did whatever to you, whatever happened to you, power still. Or you can go back and take your power back and learn your lesson. Learn why or how not to let that happen again. Reshape it. Use gratitude. I'm glad this happened. I don't know. Sometimes that doesn't fucking work, but it honestly, it does. Absolutely. There's a way to do it. You can always switch everything you go through. There's always other perspectives. That's what's super cool about me. Going through life, always looking at other people's perspectives. Because it gave me the ability to go back and reshape crap from something, from another perspective in the room to make it okay. It doesn't mean that whatever happened in the past is okay, but now I deem it to be okay because I'm looking at it in another perspective. And I'm choosing that. I'm the creator of my own world. I'm the creator of my mind. I'm the creator of my past. I'm the creator of the storybook, the movie, film. I'm cutting that out. I'm going to look at it in a different way. Because I'm in control. I have the power to do that. And once I'm done with it, I'm done with it. I don't have to go back and relive it again. Unless I need to use it for another human being to just be vulnerable. And I'll do it. And this sucks. That's the worst part. Me having to walk through and relive stuff again in front of humans, it's just part of it. I have to give to get. I have to open up and be raw and vulnerable so they give me a little bit of notoriety. It gives them power over me so they can, it gives them familial, I can't even talk. It just lets me connect to them because I am giving something that I shouldn't be giving you, something embarrassing. It just frees people to respond in their own way. It makes them comfortable enough to open up so they can face whatever they're going to talk about, so they can hear it again and make it real again, and then maybe they can beat it in the moment and gain their power back. That's kind of how it is what it is, and that's part of healing. But you got to cut that wound open again, man. And it is what it is. It's not the funnest thing, but it happens quick, and it gets faster and faster. And you start feeling results from it. You start seeing results from it. And it's like working out in the gym. You start seeing results. You start eating healthy. You start seeing results. And this, you start feeling results. You start are being results. You start becoming happier. You become lighter, physically lighter. You feel lighter. Like I said, you know, it's just different. It's weird. It's overwhelming sometimes, but it's worth every bit of it. It's worth every bit of it, and I'm hungry, bro. I'm hungry. Dude, I'm starving. Not really starving, but I'm hungry. I need to get some food. Today was perfect. Today was everything I thought it would be and more. In which I don't think about it. So it's whatever. It is what it is. My finger's throbbing. It's gonna be sore as balls tomorrow. But it's my peace finger. So if it's bigger, my peace sign will go further. So it all works out in the end. But blood never hurt nobody. If you ain't bleeding, you ain't trying. You know what I'm saying? And that was perfect, man. I got a bunch of pictures framed, and I'm excited about them. I just can't wait to let people see them. Because they're me. They're me. And, they're fun. They're cool. And they've done what I needed them to do for me. Hopefully they can help other people. And hopefully my life can help other people. Hopefully my way of living can help other people. Hopefully me posting stuff can help people. Even if it helps one or two or three or four, who cares? All of them. That's my goal. But ultimately, I can't do it for you. I can't make you do anything. I don't want to. That's not free will. But I can live my life in a way that you have to look. You have to see. And you can't deny what I'm doing and saying. This is the truth. You can't deny it. You can run from it. I'm sorry if you do. It sucks in hell. But you created it. You created your own hell. You created your own consequences. You created your own life. God didn't have anything to do with it. He let you do what you wanted to do. He gave you free will. That's love. That's love. Ahala. Peace.
Such long days and longer nights, visions running through my mind of how it'd feel to be with you. So much easier to hide than to face what we might find. There'd be so much less to lose. 'Cause the more that we fight it, we drown. The more we deny it, it comes out. The more moments stay quiet, it gets loud, cause step that's left is to get this off our chest. I don't know why you won't, cause the more that we fight it, we drown. The more we deny it, it comes out. The more we stay quiet, it gets